Let's hear your views on the topic that we've discussed so far.
I'm not doing. Do you hear me when I speak? Speak like this. You know, fine. I'm not going to speak about exorcism in my lecture here. Maybe it comes in the other program block later. But I've been asked to speak about religion and science, religion and skepticism, from my particular perspective, which is the perspective of a priest who lives religion. So, the lecture has been given the title Priest's View, and I chose to give it a subtitle Skeptical Approach to Religion from Within. Because it's really a different thing to comment on religion from outside and to comment on religion from inside, from within. And when I will be speaking about religion, I have to say I will be speaking mainly about Christianity as I experience it and as I live it. Because we've already heard, and you've heard I studied the history of religion, I have to mention that there are various religions and that even the scientific study of religion hasn't come with a sufficient definition of a religion as such. There are many attempts, but none of them really successful. So I will be mainly speaking about my own experience, just to give you a basic idea about who I am and from which standpoint I speak. Maybe a few things about myself. I grew up in a non-believing family, partly openly atheistic family in the communist Czech Slovakia. I was baptized as an adult by my own decision. I studied theology after I studied history of religion. And I also studied quite a deal of Near Eastern archaeology, what you may call the biblical archaeology, which is for many fundamentalists seen as the arch enemy of faith, because the archaeologians are those who prove the Bible wrong. I will speak about it a bit. And the exorcism, that's an interesting point. I got the offer to study exorcism in Rome, and I thought, well, what a great experience for a religious scientist to see firsthand what's going on there. I was quite surprised by the curse itself, but I will speak about it maybe later, not now. At the moment, I'm working as a general secretary of the Ecumenical Council of Churches. It means I'm a church bureaucrat coordinating the cooperation between various Christian churches in Czech Republic and between churches and state. So that's more or less my standpoint from which I will be speaking. First of all, it may seem a bit strange to have a religious person speaking on Skeptics Congress. Many would consider Skeptic movement hostile to religion. Many would also consider religion hostile to Skeptic movement. The lovely lady outside of this house with this sign, Jesus Christus kocha skeptikov, Jesus Christ loves the skeptics, may not be a best example of a hostile approach to skepticism, but I am quite sure many of you have experienced hostile attitude from religious people toward skeptical inquiry and skeptical attitude. I am not going to be very hostile to you. I hope. Maybe a bit. Well, first of all, this. How many of you have a t-shirt like this? Hands up. Oh, not that many. I have one. I just don't wear it very often. preparing for this Congress, and I was also speaking with some of my colleagues, they made fun of me and asked me if I bring some wood for the stake. or maybe the organizers should have prepared some. Next time. I don't think, first of all, I don't think the topic of religion and skeptical inquiry has to be hostile. And what I am not going, first I have to say what I'm not going to do here. I'm not going to defend religion, surprisingly. I'm also not going to debunk religion, prove religion wrong. I'd be against myself. First of all, you've heard both of it many times, I suppose. The defense of religion of various kinds, the attempts to prove religion wrong of various kinds, so I won't add to this. What I would like to tell you is that from my point of view, you have to really differentiate, because there is no such a thing as a religion as such. It's a complex reality, and when you are approaching religion from the skeptical point of view, it doesn't really matter whether from outside or from inside, you really have to differentiate. And about this differentiation, I would like to speak more in depth. And possibly, in the end, we can come to a conclusion that we have a common cause when it comes to religion. First of all, I would like to state a few obvious things. The root of modern skeptical thinking or modern scientific thinking was formed to a large extent by theologians. Not because they would, we have William Ockham here, that is famous Ockham's razor, although the Latin formulation we normally know comes from him, but it doesn't really matter. what I wanted to say, the theologians who laid the very basics, the very foundation of our critical thinking today, were not doing so because they would like to prove religion wrong. No, they were doing so because they wanted to make their religion better. And that's something I would argue a critical thinking about religion can do, and I'm very grateful for my two speeches before, which generally, at least I think you came to the very same conclusion, and I would like to thank you for that, because I would argue that critical inquiry makes religion better, and it is an imperative for anyone who really wants to live out his religion. Here we have the two founders, Benedict Spinoza and René Descartes, as the founders of a critical thinking to some extent. Both of them, that's an interesting point, both of them were denounced as heretics by their own communities. And that brings us to another problem. Critical thinking in religion often leads to conflict. Not everyone in the religious community is capable of critical thinking. It is so. And not every attempt to practice the critical thinking inside a religious community is met with approval. I will speak about it a bit more when I will mention the problem of the Bible and archaeology. When we address the question of science and religion, then we come to the classical definition, which also is a classical defense of religious people when met with scientific inquiry, that the science is agnostic towards untestable claims, which is obviously true, but when used as a defense by religious people, it often has to be read like shut up and let me do my mumbo jumbo, which is obviously wrong. It is true that the basic truths of religion are untestable. They are like axioms. You can believe in them, you may not believe in them, but that's pretty much everything you can do about them. The problem is, religion can't be reduced to those untestable claims, like the existence of God. But religion as such is much more complex things and has many things that are pretty much testable. This basic defense doesn't apply to those things that are testable and those claims that are testable. Let me start with one pseudo-religious claim that you probably know. The Russell's Teapot. A very famous allegory of religious claim. Bertrand Russell made as an example a claim that there is a teapot flying somewhere in space orbiting the sun, and he asked anyone to prove it wrong. Otherwise, you have to believe it. Of course, you don't have to, but it is a good example of a religious fact that can be proven. The reason why Bertrand Russell made this claim is that he wanted to show that the burden of proof lies upon the person making an unfalsifiable claim, which applies only to an extent from my point of view. Well, first of all, when we speak about the core religious beliefs, there is no burden of proof, because nobody wants to prove them right or wrong. Because a religious claim that you can prove right or wrong ceases to be a religious claim. It will be a scientific fact. So, in fact, the teapot isn't a really good analogy, because if there would be a teapot flying somewhere around the sun, with enough energy and with enough technical equipment, you would ultimately prove it right or wrong, because you would ultimately find it. The existence of God, on the other hand, is something that you can't prove using any scientific methodology at all. So, the core beliefs, those core beliefs in any religion, and now I'm mainly speaking for my own, are axioms. They are untestable. They can be accepted, they can be rejected, but they can't be ever proven. On the other hand, everything else can be proven, and anything else has to be tested by a critical inquiry. I will give my own example. There is a belief that I share, that miracles are possible. That's basic belief that you can't prove right or wrong. But on the other hand, any account of actual miracle is something that you have to critically investigate and prove right or wrong. And normally, at least from what I've seen, you prove it wrong. What applies to those core beliefs, in other words, doesn't apply to the religion as a whole. That's the differentiation we have to make. This is a very interesting thing. This is an example of an indigenous religion, the so-called Kero cult, of people from Malaysia, I think,
Oceania,
somewhere in Oceania, that they are worshipping statues of American planes that used to bring stuff to the soldiers there. Then the soldiers left, the planes left as well, and with them the precious cargo that they brought, and they are worshipping the statues, hoping to bring the planes back. So that's exactly the kind of thing that you have to critically examine. It may be in the Christian tradition, we have in theology, we have a strong current of thought that goes in this direction of critically examining the truths. And one of the most interesting, at least from my point of view, is the biblical criticism. I have to put my papers into order. Yes. Biblical criticism, today, at the most of the theological faculties, from the fundamentalist point of view, saw as a grievous assault on every truth that the religion stands for. Closely cooperating with fields like archaeology. I will give a very, very illustrative example of what biblical criticism and archaeology can do. You probably know the story of Jericho, about Joshua and his army marching around the city, blowing horns, and on the seventh time, the walls came crumbling down. Well, if we go beyond the biblical text and look at the archaeology, as did Kathleen Kenyon in the 50s, a famous Israeli archaeologian, we'll find interesting things. There are 20 successive layers of settlement in Jericho, but the big ancient city was destroyed in 15th or 16th century BC, so pretty much 200 or 300 years before the migration of Israeli tribes. So when the Israeli people came across Jordan, there were no Jericho there. There were only ruins of an ancient city. That's the archaeological fact. So how do we relate those findings with the biblical text? And more importantly, does this fact prove Bible wrong? If we would take Bible as a course book of history, or even worse, a course book in biology or something like this, it would definitely prove Bible wrong. But we can't take back the Bible like this, and we shouldn't. It isn't a historical document, it isn't a book of biology, and even the Christian and Jewish tradition approves to this. The Christian and Jewish tradition have a different ways to interpret Bible, or not only on the literal sense, also on the allegorical and other ways of interpreting. The point is, the core message of Bible and of the book of Joshua as well isn't the historical facts that are described there, it's the attitude between the God and man that is shown in those stories. And this message is not influenced by the facticity or unfacticity of those stories. It's pretty much what would have been said in the first lecture today. We can also go to the New Testament, when it gets much more personal for Christians, and ask about the facticity of events described in the New Testament. Actually, 19th century theology, or early 20th century theology, theological modernism, did some very interesting thing. They they try to bring faith into the line with a scientific worldview, which means they try to explain the miracles described. The Testament, like Jesus walking on water, would use some kind of soap. That's true, I don't tease you, no. Really meant seriously. Or Moses speaking to the burning bush would be an ignited oil well, and the voices he heard were probably some hallucinations because of the gases. Never mind. The point is, for the message of the New Testament, the facticity of those stories are practically irrelevant. The Gospels are documents written in a particular society for particular readership, and they have to be critically examined, and it's done in the church tradition at least since 18th-19th century. Another example from the very church tradition. You probably know St. George, the dragon slayer. It probably he's venerated as a saint. He has a feast day, many nice traditions around it. Well, it wouldn't probably surprise you when I tell you that the dragon is made up. The point is, St. George is made up as well. That probably never been the actual person. It's a legend. Legend that revolves, and this brings me to the point. Legend that revolves around an archetype of a valiant Christian who is an incarnation of Christian virtues, and that's the reason why he is venerated. Not because the facticity or non-facticity of his person, and that's the reason why he can be venerated, even if you know that in fact he wasn't dead. So, brings me to a conclusion because my time is slowly up. What is the priest's view announced in the title of this lecture? First of all, critical theological inquiry, or we can say critical skeptical inquiry from within, is part of a church's tradition. It doesn't always have a decisive voice in the churches. Pity, but so is life. But it's there, at least. Secondly, core religious truths are not available for scientific inquiry, by definition. But the way religious people act upon those truths are and should be subject to scientific inquiry and skeptical evaluation. I think it's you who said that it doesn't interest you what people believe but what they do. That's exactly that, because that's what we can see and what we can evaluate. And third and most of all, skeptical inquiry into religion from within is beneficial for the religion itself, because a lack of critical thinking inside religion would ultimately lead to bigotry and fundamentalism. And it really is only a critical thinking from within that can guard religion as a social reality from bigotry and fundamentalism, something that is desperately needed today. I mean, the critical inquiry, not the fundamentalism. And we also have to say, let me conclude with a story. When we studied Old Testament literary criticism in Bern with one of my great teachers, we were generally speaking about all things that are written in the text, but in fact weren't. at the end of every lecture, the professor would say, those of you who are going to the church service, don't you dare tell this from the pulpit. We have to say, not everybody in the church, in the real existing church, is, how should I say, is capable of high level of critical thinking. And that's a reality we have to live with. And even for people who can't critically examine their own religion, the religion could be beneficial, but it has to have this inner corrective of critical thinking. That's probably my conclusion. We, by critically examining the religion, we are making religion better. Thank you.